Era uma pequena. O que é isso? Desculpe, tenho um problema aqui. Tenho um problema, desculpas. Cadê? Olá. Desculpas. Tudo estava pronto e agora não. Bom. Ok. Bom. Agradeço muito ao meu editor Edson Manuel de Oliveira Filho, diretor da AE Realizações, por ter publicado a versão brasileira do meu livro sobre a catástrofe nuclear de Chernobyl. Um grande agradecimento também ao meu tradutor, o amigo Pedro Sete Câmara, e a meus dois amigos aqui presentes, João César de Castro Rocha e Maurício Righi, cujas obras são impressionantes. E o Maurício escreveu um prefácio muito bonito para a edição brasileira do meu livro. É uma honra e um prazer de compartilhar este lançamento com eles. Como eu costumo dizer, há mais de 40 anos que eu falo português muito mal. Falar, sim, infelizmente. Mas falar de uma coisa tão técnica como um acidente nuclear maior, mesmo se for limitado ao ponto de vista filosófico, em português, fica além da minha competência. Então, vou falar em inglês, uma vergonha, eu sei. Franceses brasileiros que compartilham idiomas oriundo do latim e que precisam de um idioma alheio, como o inglês, não dá, mas é assim. Bom, então, vou falar English. I'm going to speak English now. Okay. So I'm going to use slides. Actually, it's going to be a PowerPoint presentation. And so I have to do something here. Okay. Everyone can see the slide here. Back
Yes,
function.
we can see it.
Diary of an
Perfect.
outraged man, which is a translation of the French. Of the French. This is a French version. Retour de Chernobyl, journal d'un homme en colère. Et the Portuguese translation is Retorno de Chernobyl, diario de um homem irado. O homem irado sou eu, claro. Bom, I'm supposed to speak English, so. On April 26, 1986, the fourth reactor of the Lenin nuclear power plant north of Ukraine exploded. That was the so-called Chernobyl accident or catastrophe. Chernobyl is the name of a small village situated 2 kilometers, which was situated 2 kilometers from the nuclear power plant. This was not an atomic explosion. It was a thermal explosion. I'm not going to talk, I don't do it in my book either. That's not where my interest lies. I'm not going to talk about the causes of this accident. It was a stupid accident guided from Moscow, because at the time, of course, Ukraine was part of the Soviet Union. Huh? The Soviet Union, as you certainly know, collapsed in 1991. We're not close to the collapse, but not yet. And so it was an experiment which turned into a catastrophe. So it was a thermal explosion. The temperature increased a lot at the core of the reactor, and the pressure augmented to such a level that the lid was blown away. And maybe fortunately, because if the lid had not been blown away, this accident might have turned into a nuclear reaction. That is a small atomic bomb, if you like. So it was what is called in English a near miss. We are that close to a nuclear accident. But of course, the fact that the lid was blown away has as a result the fact that a cloud of radioactive material, mainly plutonium-239, came out of the reactor and hovered above a good part of Europe. This is the so you see the this was the roof of the fourth reactor. That's the day after, April 27th, and you see a helicopter pouring or dropping huge quantities of sand and boron to put out the fire. I was there, let me tell you why I was there. I was there because I was participating in a research group, and my colleagues were sociologists, economists, philosophers, artists even, and were there to prepare for an exhibit about the accident. So 19 years later, and this exhibit took place in Barcelona, Spain, for the 20th anniversary. So the year after, that means 2006. Okay, this is all I'm going to say about the context because we have very little time. So I want to approach the problem posed by this catastrophe from a philosophical point of view. And I'm going to distinguish between five different topics: invisibility of evil, the disconnect between evil and evil intentions, the concept of near misses, which I've already mentioned. Fourth, the factual and the normative are irremediably intertwined. And fifth, the symbolic dimensions of a nuclear accident, which will allow me to speak of something that happened after my visit there. That is another major nuclear accident in Fukushima, Japan. So I went so to Chernobyl, but I also went three times to Fukushima. And I will say a few words about Fukushima. Invisibility of evil. This is a very important concept in philosophy, especially the philosophy of catastrophes. Radioactive substances are, of course, invisible. You cannot see them, you cannot taste them, you cannot feel them, etc. As a result of the accident, entire towns, cities, villages were erased and or evacuated. I'm going to see the example of one particularly important. And then I will introduce the new concept of ruin and the major question, where are the dead of Chernobyl? Okay, this is a map of Ukraine, sorry. You see Ukraine is surrounded by a number of states: Romania, Hungary, Slovakia, Poland, Belarus, Russia. At the time it was, I repeat, in 1986, the Ukraine was part of the Soviet Union. So it was not Russia, but the Soviet Union. And Belarus also was part of the Soviet Union. The capital of Ukraine was and is, since the 9th century of our era, Kiev. It's on a big, big river called the Dnieper, which cuts the Ukraine in two parts. On the east of the Dnieper, they speak Russian. On the west of the Dnieper, they speak Ukrainian. And you see that the Dnieper flows into the Black Sea, at a place which is not far from Odessa. Odessa, which before the Second World War was a major Jewish city. And you see also that this place is not far from the Crimean Peninsula. And you know also that Crimea is no longer part of the Ukraine because it's been invaded by Putin. Okay. You see where Chernobyl is. Chernobyl is north of Kiev, actually 100 kilometers north of Kiev, very close to the border with Belarus, almost on the Dnieper. Actually, it's on a river because a nuclear power plant needs a river or the sea to be cooled down, of course. So it's a tributary of the Dnieper called the Pripyat. That's a river where Chernobyl was. Okay, so this is the better map of Ukraine. Here you see also the situation of Ukraine, etc., Belarus, the three Baltic states, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, Poland. So that night, the wind was blowing in the direction of the northwest. So the cloud avoided a big part of Ukraine, went over Belarus, the three Baltic states, Poland, and Western Europe, Holland, Belgium, well, part of France, and even Italy south, etc. It's considered, one considers that 20 million people were touched in a way or another by this cloud. Chernobyl. Chernobyl in Cyrillic characters. Cherno, you certainly know this word in Russian because it's it means black. Black because that's the, if we had more time, I would play the most famous Russian song called Ochi Chorny, which means dark eyes, black eyes. You certainly, I'm not going to sing it because it's not raining in Paris currently. So it might rain if I sang it, but you certainly know it. And Bill means absinthe. So Chernobyl means black absinthe. And this is this plant, which is black in the Ukraine and which makes the liquor called absinthe. Beautiful forest made of pines, as you can see, and birch. I've found the Portuguese word for birch, it's betula, or vidoeiro também. Bom. Absolutely beautiful, luxurious forest. This is a beautiful house in the forest. This is a forest with a slogan which says, the forest is the lung of the planet. And if you know the Cyrillic characters, you see here, planeti. Well, the forest is the lung of the planet, except that this forest, luxurious forest, beautiful, is crammed with a number of radioactive substances. Cesium-137, that's a nuclear number, atomic number. That's the number of atomic number that means that the sum of the number of protons and neutrons, whose half-life is 30 years. That is, in 30 years, the quantity, initial quantity is divided by two. Strontium-90, its half-life is 29 years. Plutonium-239, its half-life is 24,000 years. 24,000 years. That is, in 24,000 years, there will be half the quantity of plutonium that went off the reactor. So maybe for 40,000 years, at least, there will be no life in that region. But you don't see it exactly. You see exactly the opposite. Let me show you a lake or a pond. We had a good picnic by it, which was absolutely folly, crazy, but and with lot of rusted boats. And in that lake, we don't see them. You see huge carps, absolutely huge carps. I've never seen so. In the same way that the forest is so luxurious. So people who come there for the first time believe that all these things are radioactive. The carp starts big because they are radioactive. The sad story is that they are not. If they are so big, it's just because they are no longer fished. Because the major predator of nature, as we know, is human beings. Okay, so that's why the forest is so beautiful. That's why the carps are so big, because human beings are no longer there. That's a very sad story. Here at the in the back, you see a radar, because the Chernobyl power plant was meant to produce not only the electricity of Kiev and the region of Kiev, but also plutonium for the Soviet nuclear bombs. That's a mixture of nuclear and civilian nuclear energy and nuclear, that is atomic bombs. Don't eat that apple, and please, you would die in just a few days. Another form of the invisibility of evil is the sarcophagus that used to encompass the remaining nuclear fissile material. And made of concrete and iron, it stands there. And it when we were there, so in 2005, that was the sarcophagus. But it was already leaking. So we are crazy to stay there, by the way. And so they built, actually the French built another, so this structure is called a sarcophagus. It's a very appropriate name. The French built another sarcophagus around this. There was no way to collapse to this first sarcophagus, because that would mean exposing the radioactive material. And so this is the new sarcophagus, which I've never seen, around the, so it was inaugurated, if I can put it this way, in 2016. Okay, so the radioactive material is completely invisible, of course. It cannot be exposed to the air. Another form of the invisibility is the this new concept of ruin. 30 kilometers far from the nuclear power plant, there was a city of 50,000 people, mainly the workers working at the nuclear power plant and their families, 50,000 people. So the buildings are still there. They were not very pretty, but the Soviet Union was very proud of this city called Pripyat, the same name as the river on which it stands. These are the buildings. So we visited them inside. Oh, you see here Hotel Russia, Russian hotel. The Ferris wheel where the kids played. A very vibrant city. If you go to this site here, I'm not sure it's still active, but www.pripyat.pripyat.com, you'll see how people lived in that big city before the accident. So the buildings are in place, except that there is no life, not even a cat, not even a dog. So that's why I called I speak in terms of the inversion of the of the concept of ruin. Think of Pompeii in Naples, near Naples, and the Vesuvio, which volcanic explosions. You know the story of Pompeii. So the city was destroyed. The houses were destroyed, but life continued. Here it's exactly the opposite. The buildings remain, but there is no longer any life. And for 40,000 years, maybe. That's another form of the invisibility of evil. Okay, so the city was evacuated 4 days after because it was, the accident was kept secret. So in haste, so you have this, a puppet here, a doll. Okay, the most important invisibility is the invisibility of the dead people that who came out dead because of the accident. A big scandal, which explains why I subtitled my book Diary of an Outraged Man, Irado, in Portuguese, is that the official number of dead people due to Chernobyl is 40, 40. In Kiev, you hear numbers like 400,000 dead people. No, never such a discrepancy has been attached to a catastrophe. How can one explain that? And my book is mainly about how to solve that enigma, which is actually a scandal. And this radical uncertainty, of course, we don't know how many people died because of Chernobyl, undermines the public trust. This is the first one of the first reports, that international report that dates back to 2001. Chernobyl caused 31 dead as the result of the injuries inflicted by 200 sievers, that's a unit of radioactivity, clinically attributable to exposure to radiation. Well, plus cancers of the thyroid among children, etc. To date, there is no internationally authenticated proof of any impact on public health that can be attributed to exposure to radiation caused by Chernobyl. 4 years later, the official report said Chernobyl, the true scale of the accident, a total of up to 4,000 people could eventually die of radiation exposure from the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. Okay, so could eventually, it's not certain. That was the official report. If you read my book, you'll see that my estimate is actually 40,000, not 400,000, but 40,000. So who are the dead people that the official reports cannot deny? Well, these are the liquidators. The liquidators, there were 800,000 liquidators who, during the 3 years after the accident, cleaned up the mess produced by the accident. They were supposed to, so you see them here climbing, not on top of the fourth reactor, and you saw how completely destroyed it was, but on the next reactor, on the third reactor, from which they could reach out to the fourth reactor. So this is what the kind of work they were doing. So can you imagine how they could stay 2 minutes on top of this? No. They stayed maybe half an hour, et cetera. And then they returned to, they were coming from all parts of the Soviet Union. Half of them were soldiers, half of them were volunteers. Certainly a good proportion of them died of this exposure to the radiations. Look at this, 2 minutes, impossible. Okay. This was my first point. Second point, disconnect between evil and evil intentions. That's a very important philosophical issue. for people interested in catastrophes in general and the catastrophes of the 20th century in particular. So here my theoretical models are Hannah Arendt, who I suppose is very well known in Brazil, Günther Anders, much less known, unfortunately, who was her first husband, but that's anecdotal. Ivan Illich, who was my master, my mentor, I should say. Hannah Arendt and Günther Anders were two Jewish Germans who had as a professor Heidegger, a Nazi. That's a problem, of course. Ivan Illich, that's a different story, but all of them stressed that there is a new regime of evil in the 20th century that appeared in 20th century, characterized by the disconnect between evil and evil intentions. Hannah Arendt studied in particular the Holocaust or Shoah, as we say in Europe, in her book, Eichmann in Jerusalem, subtitled A Report on the Banality of Evil. And she had this phrase, "Today, even crimes so immense that the earth itself cries out for retribution are committed by people with motives that are no worse than banal," what she called the banality of evil. So that was the scandal that she was studying. Eichmann, well, we know now that Hannah Arendt was not completely right about Eichmann. Eichmann hated the Jews, but at least he presented himself as a pawn in the Nazi system. So he had very small intention. I mean, his goals were very simple and mediocre. He wanted to please his boss. And all of us, if we have a boss, we want to please him or her. Problem that his boss was Goebbels, the Nazi minister of propaganda. We know the story. And I'll skip this. Günther Anders studied mainly Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And in his very important book, Hiroshima ist überall, which in German means Hiroshima is everywhere, he has this phrase, as the world becomes apocalyptic, it presents itself to us as the paradise inhabited by criminals without wickedness and by victims without hatred. And that's awful. The disappearance of human sentiments, human passions, etc. Illich, who was my mentor once again. Maybe this name doesn't mean anything to at least our youngest auditors or spectators, but he was a great critic of industrial societies, and words like that he coined really, we are still using them, like conviviality, counterproductivity, et cetera, et cetera. And he has this phrase, "Today we must fear more those whose profession is to bring about the good than the malicious persons." And it turns out that the mission of the World Health Organization, WHO, and you may have in mind that Trump a month ago decided to stop funding the World Health Organization, is to accelerate and enlarge the contribution of atomic energy to peace, health, and prosperity throughout the world. Yeah, maybe, but the problem is there are accidents such as Chernobyl and Fukushima. I'm not saying anything about the problem of the nuclear waste. What do we do with the nuclear waste? Okay, third chapter. I have to hurry, sorry, but it's just an introduction to the main ideas of the book. Near misses. That's the notion of the damages that might have happened. Robert McNamara, who was the Secretary of Defense of President Kennedy, and then of President Johnson after Kennedy was assassinated, had this phrase when he was asked whether nuclear deterrence had protected us against the nuclear Holocaust. He said, that's American slang, we lucked out, which means we're lucky, and we came out unscathed by this. This nuclear Holocaust didn't take place, but nuclear deterrence didn't have anything with it. In his memoirs, Robert McNamara cites 32 cases, among which 10 during the Cuban Missile Crisis, where we were, and I don't know if you see me, he has this gesture, we were that close to a nuclear war. We escaped it by luck, only by luck. And the question I want to pose is that the failure of nuclear deterrence? One could say exactly the opposite. It's because we're all the time playing with fire, getting very close to the black hole, let's call it the image of the black hole, that is the nuclear disaster. We're not too far and not too close. Not too close because we would have perished, not too far because that kept in our minds the fact that it was awfully dangerous. So near misses play a very important role in nuclear deterrence. And one could say, and that's what I do in my book, that Chernobyl, I remind you, is very close to Kiev, 100 kilometers. Had Chernobyl been not a thermal accident, but a nuclear accident, the whole city of Kiev, and much more, of course, would have been annihilated. And Kiev, just a few images I'm going to show you very quickly, it's a beautiful, beautiful city. The Russian civilization started in Kiev in the 9th century of our era. I don't want to defend Putin, but Putin has claims over Ukraine, and it's not completely unwarranted, unjustified, because Russian civilization started in Ukraine, in Kiev. So a few monuments of Kiev to show you how beautiful it is. Okay. This beautiful city would have been annihilated. That's our group. I mean, just part of our group, two sociologists on the left. The guy with the pink rose, the pink shirt, sorry, is a great artist, and he painted the sarcophagus at different times of the day, as Matisse had painted the Cathedral of Rouen in France. And on the right, that's me, 15 years ago. Okay. Fourth, that's a much more demanding topic. The factual and the normative are irremediably intertwined. There are two kinds of exposure to the radiations. The exposure to the explosion itself, you receive the all these radioactive materials directly. And that was the case of the liquidators, of course. But there is another form of exposure, which leads to the problem of small doses. So it's a very soft exposure. It's the milk you drink, the air you breathe, the wood that you burn in order to get heated, and et cetera, et cetera. And all these things of nature are, as I said before, completely contaminated with strontium and especially plutonium. Strontium, cesium, and plutonium. So these exposures are, the quantity of radioactive material that you absorb by eating, by drinking, by breathing, by warming yourself, etc., are very, very small. Very small. Okay, and this is a map of the region between Chernobyl and Kiev, as you can see, and the redder the area, that means a more intense radioactivity. So it's all these zones are intertwined. Okay? It's a mix. It's a mix. Now that leads us to a very, very difficult philosophical issue that dates back to the Greeks. Actually, it's called the Sorites paradox. And Sorite, the word Sorite means heap in Greek, ancient Greek. So 2 years before the accident, a great book by Derek Parfit, who died 3 or 4 years ago, a great British moral philosopher. The book called Reasons and Person. Parfit, as if he were guessing what would happen in Chernobyl, put the following two questions. There are actions or events that have an extremely low probability of having a considerable effect. However, should a moral or rational calculation consider these probabilities as zero just because they are insignificant? And that's a problem of nuclear accidents in general. The a priori probability that a nuclear power plant that is, let's say, 20 kilometers east of Paris, let's talk about Paris now, explodes like Chernobyl did, is very, very, very small. Électricité de France, a French national company that produces electricity, computed it to, let's say, one every century, no more. But if that happened, the consequences would be momentous. One third of the French population would be either dead or injured or, So how do you do when you multiply zero by infinite? And that's a question. But the dual problem is the following. There are actions or events that have imperceptible effects, but which affect a large number of people. So here it's zero multiplied by infinite, not infinite multiplied by zero. But should we dismiss these effects as insignificant just because they are imperceptible? If you say yes, we should dismiss them because we cannot perceive them, then you do as the international reports. Well, there are 40 dead people or 4,000, but no more. But I think we should say, as Derek Parfit argues, no, we cannot take very, very small as equal to zero. Let me show you that that's a Sorites. Okay, Sorites paradox. What is it? Sorites means heap. So if you take two stones, they don't make up a heap of stones. And you need more stones than that. Now, if you add one stone to a non-heap of stones, you still get a non-heap of stones. And however, a heap of stones is just made of a number of stones. Okay, maybe it's simpler, it's clearer if you take the same paradox in the form of the bald person. The bald person has few hairs on his scalp. Okay, if you add one hair to a bald person, he remains a bald person. And however, a person who is not bald just has a number of hairs. So where's the another form? The museum guard informs his visitors that the dinosaur on display is 70 million and 6 years old. 70 million and 6 years old. That's strange, isn't it? So one day a little girl challenged this number, 70 million and six, how do you know that for sure? The guard looks down and explains, when I took the job, they told me it was 70 million years old. And that was 6 years ago. But you understand. Well, you should be laughing now. You should be laughing. Okay. It's, of course, a 70 million year old T-Rex is still 70 million years old 6 years later. So do these very, very tiny quantities count for zero? If you count them from zero, then you get Chernobyl produced 40, maximum 4,000 dead people. If you reason otherwise, you reach the total of 40,000. But the problem is the following. When radioactive doses are very spread out in time and distributed over a vast population, it is impossible to tell if any given person who dies of cancer or leukemia has done so as a result of Chernobyl. All we can say is that the a priori probability of them dying of cancer or leukemia has slightly increased as a result of Chernobyl. So the 30 or 40,000 dead the nuclear disaster has caused cannot therefore be named. They have no name. The official thesis concludes that they don't exist. Okay, I repeat, the only thing you can say, someone dies of cancer, was it due to Chernobyl? No, the only thing you can say is that the probability that that person had to die of cancer was increased by a very small quantity, a near miss, if you like, due to Chernobyl. The same with the Chernobyl babies, unfortunately. I'm going to show you very quickly a number of pictures. I don't want to insist on this. Okay, these kids were born of a mother who was pregnant when the accident took place. Okay, this is how they were born. This is a horse with five legs. This is a cow. This is a dog. So the only, was these horrors caused by Chernobyl? No, it's the same. The only thing you can say is that the a priori probability that this kid was born the way he was born was slightly increased due to Chernobyl. Okay, that's the big philosophical problem. Okay, Fernanda, maybe I should stop here, no? What do you think? And skip the fifth.
No, go ahead, Jean-Pierre. No.
But you are supposed to talk also. Okay.
No, but we're here to listen to, if Maurice agrees, just please go ahead.
Yes, go on.
Okay.
Continue, please.
I'm almost over, actually. The symbody dimensions. This is the place for me to broach the topic of the connection between nuclear civilian energy and the atomic bomb. And I'm going to take the case of Fukushima precisely. And I want to quote here from the great, I don't know if you know him, he's working, I suppose so, in Brazil, the great, great Japanese writer Murakami, beautiful books. Doesn't matter. So the accident of Fukushima took place on March 11th, 2011. And the year after, I was in Tokyo and then I went to Fukushima to study this case. And Murakami gave a talk in which he said the following. March 2012, yeah. In the same way that Japan sacrificed herself by being the first and only victim of a nuclear attack in 1945, in order to show the world how abominable nuclear weapons are, she, Japan, sacrificed herself by being the first and only victim. Well, that's to forget Chernobyl. First and only victim of a major nuclear accident in order to show the world how dangerous nuclear energy is. Isn't that extraordinary? No. And actually, the presupposition here is that, well, it's not just presupposition, it's a fact that Japanese sociologists have studied Never ever before Fukushima had the Japanese made the connection between nuclear civilian energy and the atomic bomb of which they were the victims and the sole victims, only they. Never before. Now it's different. They make the connection between the French. You may know that, well, maybe not, doesn't matter. France, until recently, had 80%, that's the only country in the world, 80% of its of its electricity produced in nuclear power plants. And the French from this, and there has always been in France a sharp opposition to this state of things and against. When I was young, I was an activist against nuclear energy. That's different now. If we discuss, I can tell you why, but we have always made the connection between the atomic bomb with the French and the nuclear energy. But the Japanese, it took them, from 45 to 2011 to make that connection. Okay, so I'm finished with more time and more, et cetera. I would have broached two more topics that are in my book, that's what I call the ethical and political dimensions, the connection with climate change. It might be the case that if we don't change our ways of life, there is no way for the country who master it to do without nuclear energy. That's a political question, the compatibility between nuclear energy and democracy. Because if, as I've tried to show, and I showed that better in my book, and Mauricio in his preface insist on that, if nuclear energy requires on the part of the technocrats, I call them nucleocrats, require them to lie, even if their lies are not, even if their lies are not conscious, they are not aware that they are lying. So in a sense, they are not real lies. So the question arises, in a full-blown democracy, can we have nuclear energy? Just one last word. After I wrote my book, I received death threats. Amiasas de morte. Okay, but those threats didn't come from the nucleocrats, that is the nuclear technocracy. It came from ecologists. The ecologists were some of them were very, very angry at me. And why? Because in my book, I take it as an assumption, as a hypothesis, that these nucleocrats, the nuclear industry, the proponents of the nuclear industry, have good intentions. You remember maybe the quote I made of the WHO slogan, thanks to nuclear energy, we'll have peace, prosperity, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I take these people at what they are saying. These people have very good intentions, and it makes their case even more outrageous, I would say, because they have good intentions and they produce evil. Evil persons who produce evil, who bring about evil, that's nothing extraordinary. But that's paradox put forward by Ivan Illich, as I said before. Okay, muito obrigado, e voilà.
Thank you for your presentation, Jean-Pierre.
Você sabe que vocês podem falar português, talvez? Não, não, bom, você escolhe, vocês escolhem, não.
Você que sabe, devagar, tanto então. Faz, tanto faz. Bom. Mas eu vou continuar em inglês, então, para dar para
conseguir, então, continue.
Eu acho melhor, né? Depois.
Ok, ok.
Não sei se, João César, não sei se gostaria de falar agora, ou posso fazer uma pergunta, não sei.
No, I think Mauricio should start because he has written a beautiful preface, so it makes sense.
Yes, beautiful preface. Yeah.
Round of questions.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll start. Thank you for your presentation. It's very inspiring and provocative, as I would expect it to be. But firstly, before making a question, I'd like to state how happy and honored I feel to be here, having been invited to take part in this conversation with you, Jean-Pierre, and with João César, two distinguished scholars in our respective fields of knowledge, and what's more important, two friends of mine. So it's always a pleasure for me to find an opportunity to learn once again from you and from João César. And yes, I have some questions for you, questions related to this extraordinary book on philosophy of science that you wrote, this book here. Okay, I show you
this book
here. Yeah.
You know, it's the first time I see
Arrival,
the book.
Arrival from Chernobyl, the journal of an enraged and angry man. And my first question to you, Jean-Pierre, would be the following. In your book, you advance the idea of an enlightened catastrophism, which in French would be an catastrophisme éclairé.
Yeah.
I'm sorry for my pronunciation in French.
No, it's very good.
I know.
Excellent.
mostly because people tend to believe that a big and nasty catastrophe, one like occurred in Chernobyl, will never happen.
Yeah.
Until it does, and it's too late to remedy it. Yes, to avoid it. So I would ask you if you could elaborate and explain in more details what do you mean by enlightened catastrophes, and how this idea of an enlightened catastrophes relates to the well-known idea of precautionary principle.
Oh.
Could you make a relation between them, the two principles? I'd like to hear from you about this, please.
My God, how time do we avail ourselves? Maybe 2 hours, 3 hours? Because that's a very, very difficult question. Of course, I would have to explain precautionary principle, the what I call the enlightened saying.
But go with the enlightened one.
Yeah, because my book, you know, I started writing on catastrophes. I think I've written already 10 books, all kinds of catastrophes, from the Shoah, the Holocaust, to Hiroshima, to nuclear accidents, to climate change, etc., to panic, financial panics, etc. In 2001, the shock for me was the 9/11, the collapse of the, so it was not technical catastrophe or natural catastrophe, or it was something else. It was a moral catastrophe, like the Shoah in sense, or call it the Holocaust, or Hiroshima. And I tried to come up with a general theory of catastrophes, independent of whether they were natural, moral, technological, industrial, or if you think of climate change, you cannot rank it anywhere in those boxes because it's everything. It's nature and it's artificial, of course. We produce climate change, etc. We change the climate now. Okay, the general theory of that. And I came up with a theoretical problem, which is to study the, okay, all these catastrophes have in common that they are predicted, predicted in the sense that we know that they will occur, but we don't know when. We don't know when. I mean, nuclear accidents, well, especially take Chernobyl, take Fukushima. There was a precedent that Murakami, incredibly, incredible that he tended to forget that there was before Fukushima, there were Chernobyl. Okay, we know that these things happen. We don't know when they will happen. We know that, cyclones, will occur. We know that moral catastrophes such as a nuclear war will occur. We don't know when. We just hope that it will be as late as possible. So my task as a philosopher was to study the time that separates us from the occurrence of these catastrophes, between now, etc. And so it's impossible to summarize, of course, my work. It was in a book that has been translated into English, not yet published. That was my first book, though, on the topic, called Pour un catastrophisme éclairé, that is, towards an enlightened. But it's been translated into Portuguese, by the way. It's been translated.
Yes, it was published by
Rosa Fund. But under a very different title, O Tempo das Catástrofes.
Yes, it's published. Yes.
It exists in Portuguese. I had forgotten that it exists in Portuguese. Okay, so our auditors, if they want to know more, they can go to this other book published by Edson Filho, O Tempo das Catástrofes. But so, this is very special temporality, and the temporality that separates us from an accident or catastrophe that will occur, but we don't know when. Let me remind you, and let me remind us, that the paradigmatic example of that is, for each one of us, our personal death. If there is something that is absolutely certain, is that I'm going to die. Yes. You too, unfortunately, Mauricio. You too, unfortunately.
I know that.
Yeah. But you don't know when. And fortunately, we don't know when. If not, we couldn't live. Okay, that's the first.
Unless I'm planning to suicide myself.
But of course. Or if you kill someone.
Which is not the case.
And you are sentenced to death. It's the, yes, of course, there are exceptions, of course. Or someone who is really very close to death and knows that she will die within the, okay. So this was my, the object of my study. And I came up with a new metaphysics of temporality, which consists, so I have to, it's impossible to answer your question in just a few sentences, but to consider that, that common notion of time, in our common notion of time, we see the future as a branching tree. Como Borges wrote in Spanish, un sendero, un jardín de senderos que se bifurcan. Un jardín de senderos que se bifurcan. Branching tree, with choices at each bifurcation, etc. My proposal is to consider the time. So there are possibles, that is, possibilities. In metaphysics, we call them possibles, at least in English, des possibles in French. And we can choose between these possibles. So I propose to change that temporality into a temporality in which the future is necessary. like a fatality, if you like. But at the same time, it's indeterminate. So one has to think at the same time a future that is necessary and indeterminate. Borges, once again, is my model. He said somewhere, he wrote somewhere, el porvenir es inevitable, pero puede no acontecer. El porvenir es inevitable, pero puede no acontecer.
That's very clever. That's very clever, except that this is poetry,
which is certainly for me.
Yes.
Very often, more interesting than philosophy.
In Brazil, we are the country of the future, but the future has never arrived. So we know that.
Yeah, but unfortunately, we'll die. I will die. That's for sure. Okay. So what else can I say? So I'm not a poet. I'm a philosopher, even a metaphysician and logician. I tried to formalize that. And I came up with interesting results. What else I could say without, you know, in a few words? But okay, it's a reflection about time, temporality. That's of course.
Okay. Thank you.
The main question.
I don't know. Okay. I'm satisfied. It's okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're very welcome.
Okay, so Jean-Pierre. First of all, let me say it is a great pleasure to listen to you. I'm not sure if you remember, but I was your student at Stanford.
But of course, I do remember.
When I was still a young man, a long time ago.
But you're still a young man.
Remember after the classes, we would go to a place to have a coffee. And we would be always very much impressed by your scholarship, by your vision, and above all, by your ability to bring together different disciplines. I remember classes in which you would combine René Girard's mimetic theory, Ivan Illich counter-system approach, and John Rawls' theory of justice, which certainly is not a trite challenge. I had prepared a small text to read, but I think it would be much better if you just have an informal conversation. Let me then, Jean-Pierre, if you allow me, let me bring to our discussion two main features of your book that I was very attracted by. And of course, I will read the book as a literary scholar. I was very much impressed by the mixture of styles and genres, because your book starts as a diary. The first two chapters are written as a diary. And this is a very smart stylistic choice, because actually the two chapters, they contradict each other. The number and statistics provided while you were in Chernobyl were very high, very tragic. The consequences were terrible. You just have shown us some of the pictures and some of the numbers. However, in the second chapter, when you are back to Paris, you are provided radically different numbers and statistics. And then in Paris, you become an outraged man. Yeah. While in Chernobyl, you are deeply engaged with and deeply moved by the terrible consequences of the nuclear tragedy. So the choice of the diary, I think, is a very, very smart stylistic choice, because it allows you to go from one pole to the other, to go from this commitment, from this emotional involvement, engagement, to the feeling of having been cheated by the number and the statistics you were given in Chernobyl. And you are very clear with this double feeling. So the first thing that I would like to remark is that is this mixture of styles and genres. Because then you are confronted with a challenge. If in Chernobyl, you were given numbers and statistics that clearly were inflated, the reason you reveal to the reader, by inflating the numbers, the economic, legal, and psychological compensations would also be higher. Mm-hmm. But then when you are in Paris, you face another challenge. The dramatic reduction of number and statistics are not neutral either, because they respond to the nuclear industry interest, because the nuclear industry felt threatened by the tragedy in Chernobyl. So the question is, in whom should Jean-Pierre Dupuy trust? Your answer is, in no one but myself. And then you have the appendix. And the appendix is a highly thoughtful, fairly complex reflection. Some of the reflections you have presented now in these 30, 35 minutes. So I was very much attracted by the mixture of genres and the mixture of styles. And while you're reading Dupuy, it reminded me of Erich Auerbach's concept of Stilmischung that is so important in his masterpiece, Mimesis. As you remember, but perhaps not everybody knows, according to Erich Auerbach, Western culture was the outcome of a Stilmischung. Western culture was the result of the coming together of the Greek perception and the Hebrew way of constructing worlds. So the Western culture in its core, in its best potential, was the outcome of Stilmischung, of mixture, of miscegenation, if you may.
Yeah.
In a very subtle way, Mimesis is a reply to another tragedy, to the Second World War, to Holocaust. Yeah. So Auerbach's answer is, our best alternative is Stilmischung, is mixture, is coming together, is bringing together different disciplines, different styles, different genres. And then Jean-Pierre, I was thinking about your own intellectual career, of your own personal trajectory.
Yeah.
An engineer, philosopher.
Well, engineer, you know, I was never an engineer.
I know, but
if I had built a bridge, I would advise you not to drive on the bridge.
I know.
But if I had built a power plant, I would advise not to
drive. I would say in the sense that you have the Polytechnique.
So, yeah, but at Polytechnique, you study mathematics and logic. You don't study engineering, yeah. You know. That's that's a peculiarity of the French ethos, it dates back to the French Revolution. Huh? It's a Polytechnique, purely mathematics.
Perhaps non è vero, ma è bene trovato. From engineer to philosopher, that's very good. No, but certainly, what I mean is that you have been able to bring together sciences and humanities, logic and the literary studies, so forth and so on. So I have two questions for you, just two questions. But then let me read the questions, it'll be easier. Do you think, Jean-Pierre, that Stilmischung, the mixture of styles, the miscegenation of genres, could also be a concept to frame your intellectual trajectory? And if so, do you think that in our current crisis of the COVID-19 pandemic, do you think that bringing together disciplines, bringing together different approaches and gazes may be an alternative to the crisis we are facing today? First question. Second question.
Okay.
In your presentation, as well as in your book, you have remarked this very powerful reflection of Günther Anders, the Hiroshima überall, Hiroshima everywhere. And you have stressed the consequences of this concept. That is actually the dehumanization of humankind, the losing of all the human traits. Do you believe that, what is the relationship that we could establish between this dehumanization, this Hiroshima überall, and your concept that is in the appendix of the book of enlightened catastrophism? And Jean-Pierre, congratulations on the book. As Maurice O'Higgins said, and as Maurice O'Higgins wrote in his beautiful preface, it's a very powerful reflection, especially for for the days we're living right now.
Yeah. For sure, it is.
Yeah, but you're too kind, huh? Because
that's our role. Our role here is to.
Yeah. Because the book has been translated into Portuguese, but not in English, not in not many languages, actually, very few. Just because people don't care about nuclear accidents. Huh? I mean, that's the reality. I've written another book since, 2 books ago, if I can put it this way, on a nuclear war. And it's the same. It's the same. People are definitely not interested in the prospect of a nuclear war. It's like, you know, like in the gospel, preaching in the desert. Preaching in the desert. So I'm very happy. I'm very happy that Brazil welcomes my work in this way, this kind of work, at least in this way. It's yeah. Now, your first question, Jean says that it's very easy for me to answer it because I've just done it. I mean, I've just given my publisher a manuscript which has the form of a diary on the coronavirus, precisely, mixing the styles exactly in the same way. Because, you know, I had plenty of time to do that. As I was telling Fernanda, this crisis at least has an impact on me because my kids, well, Brazilian, that's why, speak Portuguese a little, are in Brazil, stuck in Brazil. My grandson, who is 11 years old, stuck in Brazil. I cannot go there. And my wife, who is a North American, is stuck in Palo Alto in California, Stanford. So I've been by myself for now 8-9 months. No, I don't want you to cry, and please don't. And so in order not to become crazy, because, you know, not seeing people, it's very, very, very hard. And Zoom doesn't compensate, absolutely not. I'm in touch with, of course, my family, my beloved ones, etc., by Zoom, by Skype, by whatever you want, but it's not the same. It's really not the same. I taught my courses at Stanford from Paris, by Zoom. Actually, my students were not even at Stanford. They were all over the world, somewhere in Shanghai, Beijing, Germany, etc., because the campus is closed anyway. So, no, we cannot live that way. It's at the same time, it's absolutely necessary because my book is a fight, actually, against a number of French intellectuals, my colleagues, who tend to minimize the gravity of the pandemic, and then ask why so many resources spent, etc., and the liberties, our freedoms, the liberties that are being sacrificed, just for something like a little flu. Actually, your president said that too. Huh? The president of Brazil. I hope he's not listening to us. Yeah, he said it's a small flu. Okay, so some of the most sophisticated French intellectuals say the same.
Do not worry. Our president does not understand English, and sometimes understand Portuguese.
I understand there will be subtitles. Yeah, okay, but in Portuguese. Yeah. Anyway, so my book, this diary on the pandemic, is a fight, actually. Okay, I'm fighting my colleagues, the French intellectuals, for not taking seriously enough what's going on. And so we have a price to pay, you know, because people during the decontamination, as we put it, behaved completely irresponsibly. And now we have the second wave, which is much more terrible than the first one. Anyway, that's my new book. It will come out in February. Nobody can tell what's going to happen about this virus during the months that take us to February. Things may change, and I would bet that they would change in worse, not better. And it's a mixture, you know, that, as you said very well, as a great literary critic, the mixture of genres, of styles, allows you to do that, this kind of thing. So that's my answer. So the book will come out in, maybe Brazil will be interested in, actually Brazil, thanks to Edson Filho, and you, and Pedro Sete Câmara, thanks to you, the book is translated into Portuguese, but Brazil or even Portugal doesn't have any, well, just un gradus reich, but I mean, it's not functioning as far as I know. You have no nuclear power plants, okay. And nevertheless, you're interested in this, okay. But you might be more interested in the issue of nuclear wars, looming nuclear wars. That's much more serious. Okay, the second question, it's very, very difficult. The dehumanization of humankind. Of course, that's the, there is a word for that, it's alienation. And you're right, it's typically an Andersian, Günther Anders, favorite topic. Or it was an Illichian topic too. How could I put it? It's so present in all my work. Then, the word, the German word for alienation is, there are two words in Hegel, by the way. One is Entäußerung, and the other one is Entfremdung. Marx considered only the second word, Entfremdung, that is it's difficult to say in English, estrangement. That is, the things that I produce, that I make, appear as alien to me. That's Entfremdung. But alienation also translates, or aliénation, I suppose in Portuguese, aliénation in French, also translates the other Hegelian concept, Entäußerung, which means self-exteriorization. And in Hegel, self-exteriorization is positive, and Entfremdung, estrangement, is negative. But the fact that we, in our Latin languages, Portuguese, French, I suppose Spanish, and even English, we have only one word, alienation, to say it, is, I think, typical. Typical is not the word that was, is significant. Okay, another way to approach your question would be to say the following. Never ever have I felt something coming from we human beings, and nevertheless so alien to us than the 10, 12, 13 hours I spent in front of the nuclear reactor, actually taking risks, which I touch wood. My desk is in wood here, almost Brazilian wood, jacaranda. Because I wonder how come I haven't been suffering from a kind of cancer or what. It was crazy, but it was for our research, really. And the maybe 5-6 hours we spent in the apartments of the city of Pripyat. You saw the buildings, but inside, you walk inside, etc. It's completely deserted, of course, no trace of life. But the plutonium is there, and the cesium and the strontium. But it was not, because this is invisible. This evil form of evil is invisible, as I said. But the structure itself, the sarcophagus. Yeah, and I mentioned my friend Christophe Brisson, a painter who painted, as Maris did with the Cathedral of Rouen, the sarcophagus at different times of the day. There is an English word we speak English now. That is very interesting. And that will take us back to Girard, by the way, because we haven't spoken, almost not said a word about Girard, who's so important for all of us. This English word is awe, A-W-E. There is only one way to translate it in French, and I suppose in Portuguese, is to use two words. It's sacred terror, sacred terror. So I felt.
I'd like to pose you a question about the sacred and jihad. After you answer to João.
Okay, but maybe I'm pre-answering it in a sense. Okay, this feeling of awe, which and in English, awe, gave two different words which have opposite meanings. Awful, which means horrible, and awesome, which means wonderful. So that's just two sides of the sacred. Terror has two sides. Two words also that have opposite meanings. Terrific, which means wonderful, and terrible, which means very, very bad. So these are the two aspects of the sacred. So that's what I felt. Well, actually, I had a similar experience in 2001, in November 2001, when I went on my way back from Stanford and direction Paris, I stopped in New York City and I went to visit the hole, the big hole at the center of the, where the two twin towers were before. So the very magnitude, the ambiance, it was religious really, the people there. You know, New Yorkers are not especially kind with one another, but there you felt a sense of communion. Religious, really. And actually, I remember at the time I visited the plans, the blueprints for what would replace the Twin Towers. And at the place of the Twin Towers, the place of the whole, which replaced them, there was a space called Sacred Space, Sacred Space. So the idea of the sacred with these two components, wonderful and awful, were there present. So that's what I felt before Chernobyl. So this is my interpretation of the what you call the dehumanization, something so big. There is another word, of course, and you know it very well, both of you, I'm sure. It's sublime, it's a sublime. What's the name of this German composer, modern? Oh my God, I forgot. Concrete music, not concrete, but completely atonal music, who after 9/11 said, this was sublime. And people didn't understand. And he was scapegoated for saying, but he meant sublime in its original sense. That is something that is, it's so big, it's something in excess, that is, that it becomes not human, precisely. Like the sacred, precisely. So I'm led to respond your question, I realize, by saying the kind of dehumanization we're dealing with here is actually the not going downward, but upward in a sense. It's above us. It's above us. It's not the dehumanization that we, let's say, when you compare human beings to animals in forms of insults or dirty dog or whatever. No, it's the opposite. It's dehumanization in the sense of an appeal towards something larger than us. But this thing that is larger than us, it's not the good, it's the evil. That's a big difference. Actually, Hunter said that too. He said, but it was too pessimistic, I think, the only sacred that remains with us is the sacredness of evil. The sacredness of evil, yeah. Okay. So, and you, Mauricio, in your beautiful, you're very close to that.
Yes, following the same line of thought, I'd like to read a passage from your book on page 92.
In Portuguese, then?
In Portuguese, yes. Yeah. I'll read it in Portuguese, okay?
But please do.
That seems to me extraordinarily valuable. And so on page 92, you say here, I'll read it in Portuguese.
Yeah.
A história da energia nuclear militar e civil não é a de uma ascensão progressiva para a racionalidade, mas da emergência formidável e ridícula de falsas transcendências, de sacralizações secundárias que atendem pelos nomes de bomba e de técnica. Quando esses falsos deuses tropeçam, a dissuasão falha por falta de credibilidade, um reator diverge e consegue, por erro ou por terror, cumprir seu destino de bomba. Então, a violência que eles continham, no duplo sentido da palavra, eles a tinham dentro de si e a impediam sua saída, desencadeia-se e leva tudo por onde passa. So, could you relate this passage with Gerhard's understanding of the sacred? What kind of proximity and relation is there between this kind of technology and this archaic sacred of Gerhard's thinking?
Yeah. Difficult question too, really. First, Gerhard never really broached the topic of technology. So if we want to be Girardian in this dimension, along this dimension too, we have to invent something. You know, when I had, in my life, I have had two people whom I consider really like my mentors. It's not my professors at the university, at Polytechnique, or et cetera, et cetera. No. It's two Christian thinkers who interpreted the modern world, including its technology, as a corruption of the gospel, of the gospel. Well, you know who they are, Ivan Illich on the one hand, and René Girard on the other. And in my work on technology, of course, as far as I'm aware of what I'm doing, which is not always the case, when you know that as writers, at times there are forces that drive you to write something and you're not really aware of what you're doing. It's afterwards. So consciously, when I in my work on technology, I've been much more influenced by Ivan Illich than by René Girard. Ivan Illich, and also by Günther Anders and Hannah Arendt. With the notion of counterproductivity. I don't know what to say, Alain, beyond what I've already said with the in response to Jean César and what I said in the initial talk about awe, and technology is a source of awe. You know, I'm not against technology, by the way. So although I wouldn't be able to build a nuclear power plant or the Concorde, beautiful plane, or the a bridge or whatever, I've studied all these things, And
I'm asking this because when Jihá talks about the old sacred, the old gods, he says that the old gods, the old sacred, the violet sacred, has two aspects. There is a beneficial aspect and a malign aspect. And they are together in the same sphere, in the same divinity, in the same sacred. And I think the nuclear energy, atomic energy, has is the same. Like it produces high quantities of energy, free energy, unpolluted energy, and it's very beneficial in one side of it. And on the other side, it's very dangerous and evil, because once you have an accident or military use of it, it can be very, very destructive. So like the old gods of antiquity, the old sacred, nuclear energy has its two sides, the good and the bad, in the same power plant, I would say.
Yeah.
What do you think?
No, I think it's a good idea. It's an excellent idea. But, you know, I tried to say it in my own words just 10 minutes ago when I mentioned the word awe, that I felt awe looking at this sarcophagus. The word sarcophagus, by the way, is incredible, and because it's you have mummies in sarcophagus in general. Okay, so awful, awesome. Terrific, terrible. Terreur sacrée, sacred terror, etc. The vocabulary used. But, you know, if we're talking of nuclear weapons and nuclear energy, the relationship to Jihá would be much easier for me to make. Because, you know, nuclear weapons, they are only used today. Their only use today is to prevent the others from using them. Why do you have nuclear weapons? To deter the others from using their nuclear weapons, or to prevent, thinking of a country like Iran, for instance, to prevent those countries to develop their own nuclear weapons. And when I say that, I'm immediately thinking of a phrase in the gospel that Girard, René, loved to cite. I'm changing it slightly. Only Satan can cast out Satan.
Yes.
Nuclear weapons, that's Satan, but only nuclear weapons can contain nuclear weapons. It's exactly the same structure. Now, nuclear energy is a bit different because, you know, a nuclear power plant, in a sense, is, why do we assimilate nuclear energy in nuclear power plants and nuclear weapons? And the Japanese didn't do that until 2011. Okay. Why? Because it's, in a sense, it's scandalous to bring them together, as Murakami was doing in the quote I made. Because weapons are meant to kill people, and civilian nuclear energy is meant to bring peace, wealth, and etc.
But they may be produced in the same power plant, as you told us in your presentation, like Chernobyl. You have like one part of it is destined to civil energy, and the other part is destined to make bombs. The same power.
Yes. Because what is a nuclear reactor? What is it doing?
It's really a nuclear weapon.
It's a nuclear weapon that has been constrained. Instead of one neutron bringing about 12 neutrons, it's one neutron brings about one neutron. So it's thanks to Bohr, precisely. Boron, I think it's in English. In Portuguese, boro, no?
Boro.
Okay. That slows down the neutrons. Okay, so you have one-to-one. In the same way, that is the phrase one eye for an eye. It doesn't mean the limitless vengeance. It means the opposite. It's contained vengeance. And René liked to make that distinction. It's only one eye for an eye. It's only one tooth for a tooth. So one neutron for one neutron, that's a nuclear nuclear energy. Nuclear weapons, it's the chain reaction. Okay, so you could say that the nuclear reactor, I'm thinking what I'm speaking. A nuclear reactor is like an atomic bomb that has been restrained. That's a way to put it. So the difference, in a sense, is not that big, it's true, but it's being contained. Whereas the atomic bomb, it's the chain reaction. Like the virus, by the way, you know, the mathematical models, we talked about mathematics a few minutes ago. The virus, you know, there is a coefficient called R. It's a number of contaminations that a contaminated person brings about. Currently in France, it's 1.6. That is, every one of us who gets the virus contaminates 1.6 persons, which means chain reaction. Okay, the same models. So it's less obvious to bring together nuclear reactor and Girard than it is to bring together or closer Girard to nuclear weapons. That's what I want to say.
Jean-Pierre, if I may jump in, perhaps
you
can try to this discussion, to enlighten this discussion with this very insightful idea you proposed, that actually when we speak of alienation today or from Karl Marx on, we are always speaking about estrangement.
Yes.
Before, alienation is always negative. And of course, it has become a common word, a concept in 20th century, thanks to Lukács and his studies on alienation and reification. It's always negative. We have lost completely the Hegelian notion of self-exteriorization.
Yes.
When actually the spirit sees itself and by doing so acknowledges its travel. It is this Hegelian movement of reflection.
Yes.
And but I had not thought of bringing together this to our reflection, because then you told us very interesting things that I think that ties up with Mauricio Higgins' insight, if I have understood it. You have told us that awe combines awesome and awful. That terror has terrific and terrible. In which sense, actually, we are not living in a world that is actually reducing the complexity of this duality that is typically Girardian. It's like my mises for Girard. My mises for Girard is necessarily good in the sense of producing social reality, language, so forth and so on. But my mises is also necessarily potentially bad because it produces rivalry, crisis of indifferentiation, so forth and so on. And one of the crises of the modern world is that we have violence, but you're not able to produce a sacred any longer. Or to put it in your terms, we have estrangement, but you have forgotten self-exteriorization. We have either awesome or awful, but we do not have awe any longer. Or to also bring to our discussion, you have written this very important essay in which you have recalled us that the French verb, but also in English, in Portuguese, in the Latin language, contenir,
oui,
the same structure. Because if you contain, you keep from happen, but you can only keep from happen because you have it inside. You also contain, and because you contain, you keep it from happen. In which sense, the dehumanization that we are facing today with those nuclear tragedies, with the COVID-19 pandemic, In which sense this dehumanization, it is not an oblivion of the duality of those concepts. We do not have awe any longer. We have either or. We do not have la violence et le sacré. We only have violence or sacred. In which sense this also does not bring us to a proposal you have made, I think in the 1980s or in the 1990s, in a dialogue with Jean Robert, this philosopher is in Mexico,
by the way.
When you said once that the problem of the late capitalism, it is not scapegoating any longer. Because in order to scapegoat, you still have to have the other in your radar. But the problem of late capitalism is indifference. Dehumanization would not be indifference towards the other.
Yeah, but you know, that's a very delicate topic because in a sense, that's a topic about which I tend to disagree with Girard. And actually when my book on, not my book actually, because, but the articles that preceded my book on nuclear weapons, when these articles were published, in particular by our friends, Pier Paolo Scotland, St. Andrews.
Scott Garrows. Scott Garrows?
No. He teaches at St. Andrews. Well, he's retired now. What's his name? A very elegant gentleman, British gentleman. My God, okay. Okay, doesn't matter. They criticize me.
Jean-Pierre, I think this is a romantic rivalry, Mauricio. This is a very good colleague of ours. He's older than us, but he's an extremely, he's a British gentleman. Jean-Pierre, I think this is a sign of mimetic rivalry. We cannot remember his name because
yes, elegance. Yes. A very good example. Okay. Anyway, and my friend, great friend, with whom I've written two books at least, Paul Dumouchel, criticized me for saying the following. One has the feeling when you read Girard that humankind has found only one way of containing its violence, namely the sacred, and that all institutions, human institutions, power, money, et cetera, the judicial system, et cetera, are the offsprings of this solution, in a sense. It's obvious with the judicial system, the penal system, of course, but also with money or power, the state, etc. All the products of this find, namely the sacred, to contain our violence. And René Girard went so far as to say that all human institutions are bound to fail because they are born in violence. I'm not making it up. He's written that explicitly,
yes,
in Things Hidden, etc., etc. And so my problem with that is that excludes all politics, because we are doomed, because all our institutions, even the ones we have not yet found, are bound to fail because they are undermined by the violence they contain. And I've taken as a counter example, nuclear deterrence. Of course, nuclear deterrence is something extremely dangerous. I said it in passing, but it was too fast, of course. It consists in playing with fire. Always being very close to the, I use the image of the black hole, that is the nuclear war that would end up with humankind.
But Jean-Pierre,
not too close, not too far. Yeah.
But I think that Girard says this, in the sense that we are doomed to never stop learning about the sacred and its transfigurations along history. There's a positive way of understanding this, the Jihad statement, that we are doomed to never stop learning.
Yeah,
about the sacred and its ongoing transformations along history, its new faces.
Yeah, and for instance, nuclear deterrence. But the issue was the discussion with my friends were objecting to my work was to tell them, but nuclear deterrence, in a sense, has been working from 1945 to today. My colleagues at Stanford, the Center for the CSAC and the Center for International Security and Arms Control, and our former boss, Bob Hamilton Kelly, you remember Jean César, wow, worked at the CSAC for a while. Huh? Yeah. He was very happy to be there. One of them is Scott Sagan, who is the brother of the famous astronomer, who died, Carl Sagan, yes. Scott Sagan, when in the summer of 2015, when there was this escalation between Kim Jong-un and Trump, and I don't know if you remember or if you paid attention from Brazil to this escalation in words, but it went so far. I mean, they were really insulting each other. You impotent old man, and you for Kim Jong-un the small rocket man or something like that. Yes. Okay. We're that close. And Scott Sagan wrote, maybe the only solution to contain North Korea for us Americans is to let them develop their nuclear arsenal and play the game of nuclear deterrence. Okay. I don't want to say that is the solution to our geopolitical problems, but it worked. And my friends, our friends, didn't accept that. They said nuclear deterrence, like all human institutions, is bound to fail. And I don't disagree, but I mean, maybe with one century is not negligible. Nuclear peace. Of course, nuclear peace, that's an oxymoron. You see what I mean? So the issue fundamentally that you're posing, Mauricio, is really the stability of some of our institutions. They are more stable than René thought they were. You know, at times, no, I don't want to say bad things about René, but he wasn't, okay. We all share this great, great admiration and friendship. But at times you had the feeling that he was all the more happy when the world was becoming more dangerous, you know. And during his lifetime, there were many cases in which really the world was that close to a fatal.
The 1960s. Mostly in the 1960s, in the 60s.
During
the 60s, yes, we were very close to a nuclear war.
But you know, people at the, my friends there, Jerry Brown, who was the governor of California four times, and whom I met in Cuernavaca with Illich. He was an Illichian, and his friend William Perry was the Secretary of Defense of President Clinton. That summer, my God, I forgot. You know, we've been speaking for more than 2 hours already. Huh? It's I forgot what I wanted to say. It's absolutely sorry. What were we saying just before? That remind me. Mauricio,
you were saying that sometimes Girard appears seem to be very pessimistic about humanity and human institutions in general, and it seemed to you that he were like more happier when he when things were not doing very well institutionally for.
So the summer 2015, that's actually, it was to respond to Jean César, but you were broaching the same topic, both of you. Both William Perry and Jerry Brown were thinking that we're that close to the triggering of a nuclear war, not between the US and North Korea. I mean, of course, an exchange of nuclear attacks, sure. But behind North Korea, you had China, and then you have Russia. So, you know, the escalation goes very fast. Huh? Okay. So they were afraid, saw them being afraid. So those solutions that we found, those institutions like nuclear deterrence, work only to a certain extent. So that's, in a sense, that's what René was saying. But as long as they work, they work. Sorry, it's a tautology, but and what one shouldn't condemn them right off like that. You see, it's just to leave space for politics.
Speaking of which, I'd like to place you a last question. May I?
Yeah, but sure, please do.
The last, I promise, it's the last one, because it's
no, very please, important. I don't know actually how do you explain that we have so much time?
One of the most fruitful aspects of your book, for me, is the powerful notion you advance in the book of an invisible evil pointing towards a systemic evil. Or an invisible evil coming from a systemic evil.
Yes, absolutely so.
You have talked about this in your presentation, but which means that evil can be triggered off in a complete absence of a real spirit of wickedness.
Exactly. I repeated that today.
I'm going to quote you here. I'm going to quote you in the book. The greatest catastrophes we can glimpse in the horizon will be less the result of human weakness or human stupidity and more the cause of its lack of vision.
Short sight.
So could you please, because you were an insider of the system, you were a scientist and I am not. So could you comment more on the scientific community? The scientific community.
Scientific community.
Yes, about the people who make the decisions, about the people who write the reports, and this nucleocracy. Could you talk about them a little bit for us? Explain how does it work and what are their values or major thinking, I don't know, principles, what kind of lines of thought they follow. Could you explain for us the functioning of these people? I mean, psychologically, and mentally, symbolically, please.
Hola, that's... that's a very, 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 very,
you have to write a new book.
Very difficult question. how much time do we have?
I'm just curious to know.
Here it's already 11 p.m., but we have... I can. Until 4 a.m., it's okay. No, I'm just kidding, of course. No, it's a huge question, of course. Well, when I hear your question, I'm thinking immediately of Einstein, who was absolutely instrumental with his Hungarian colleagues, Zillard, etc., to push Roosevelt to develop the Manhattan Project and develop the nuclear bomb, and with a very good reason. With a very good reason. Einstein was himself trying to get it with his main physicist, Heisenberg. So imagine what would have happened had Heisenberg made the Nazi nuclear bomb. I would be speaking German if I existed. So it was a matter, it was a race in a sense. But after Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Einstein himself thought, regretted.
Yes.
His pushing Roosevelt so far. The same with Oppenheimer, the chief of the Manhattan Project, who, of course, was absolutely instrumental in developing that project, and it worked very, 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 very well. But after Hiroshima and Nagasaki, he was so reluctant to develop the next stage, which was the H-bomb. That's desolation of the abomination, abomination of desolation. That he was treated as a communist, which at the time was a major crime, by his former colleagues. So you see, these scientists, and the most important of them, have doubts. Have doubts. Okay, in a very different topic, in a very different field, the editing of the human genome. You know, it's called, it's an impossible name to pronounce. It's the, thanks to bacteria, you can edit the human genome and introduce, so it's called the CASPR, C-A-S-P-R, etc. You've never heard of that? Yeah, it's ultimate, the ultimate science and technique. And it's the two women who got the Nobel Prize for that. One is American, the other one French. And the American one, I met her. Well, her name escapes me now. So sorry, starting to be a bit tired. Just I don't remember her name, but doesn't matter. It's interesting to hear what they have to say about their creation. Because you know that Trump and his friends thought and still maintain that the coronavirus, current coronavirus, was made by the Chinese. And he calls it the Chinese virus. It's true that the virus was born in China. Doesn't mean that the Chinese made it purposefully. They might have made it accidentally in a lab. It's not only these animals, you know, the pen, I don't even remember the name of these, well, bats first, and then this animal who eats the bats, etc. And a chain of accidents. But thanks to this new technology, it's going to be very easy to fabricate extremely dangerous viruses. And so you have to listen to what they have to say. They have caused this to happen by scientific research, but they almost regret it. They don't really, and now it's too late anyway. One cannot go backwards. But it's so take some of the most advanced scientific and technological creations. And very often you will find that. Of course, there are stupid scientists or technologists who don't even think. But the most interesting, the same occurred also with nanotechnology. The promoters of that nanotechnology were the first one to say it can be extremely dangerous. So they are like really, really true religious people think of the saints, great saints, have doubts. They doubt. Scientists do, I think. If not, they wouldn't be great scientists. To believe is to doubt that one, and, or the truth of what one believes, really, in religion as well as in science. But that's, of course, the most interesting and most powerful scientist. No, I have a lot of respect for science and technology, actually. They can be extremely dangerous, and they are dangerous when they replace human relations with technology. Okay, that's a Nietzschean topic. But in themselves, they are even poetic, Jean César. I remember seeing, I've never boarded it, but I remember seeing the Concorde landing in Rio de Janeiro. The Aeroporto do Galeão. It was such a beauty. My God, it was such a beauty.
Yes.
It was a commercial, total commercial failure, but it was a work of art.
For sure. And
I don't want to conceal my admiration for science.
You mean the Concorde?
Sorry?
You mean the Concorde, the airplane?
Yeah, I'm talking of that. I'm talking of the Concorde, the airplane. Yes. No, I'm talking of that.
I know. I'm just kidding.
Landing at the airport, the Galeon airport. Yes. It was such a beauty. My God. Okay. And so I'm not at all a techno, how do you call them?
Technophobe.
Technophobe. Thank you very much. I'm not at all a technophobe. Yeah? It's not. and we haven't talked about climate change, but okay, maybe we shouldn't now. And so if we talked about climate change, we would have to return to nuclear civilian energy. For countries who have the mastery of this form of energy, then like climate change is so, but the climate change problem is that, you know, a power plant, nuclear power plant that explodes, like Chernobyl or Fukushima, it's visible. It's visible. So climate change is so abstract. We have just to imagine, but we don't see anything really. Well, we can see, we see the cyclones. We feel the French call canicule, that is heat waves, etc. But we don't really see them, touch them, etc. So if we had talked about that, maybe we would have come to the conclusion that for countries who master it, nuclear energy is a temporary solution. Or then we have to change radically, I'm not against that, our ways of life. But we cannot continue with our ways of life if we don't find a solution. You see, all these things are not easy.
Okay.
Oof. Bon. Mm-hmm. Who's going to?
Mauricio is the master of ceremony. So Mauricio.
No, it's Mauricio.
Now I'm turning. I'm going into the Portuguese mode again. Going back to the beginning of the presentation. So we can finalize our talk in Portuguese. Então gostaria muito de agradecer a todos, principalmente ao Jean-Pierre Dupuy, que é uma referência assim de primeiríssima linha para nós, para mim pelo menos, de um homem de estudo, de um cientista, de um intelectual. Muito obrigado, Jean-Pierre. Saudades de você. Vontade de tomar um café com você ali na Livraria Cultura.
Sim,
né? Espero revê-lo em breve. E também agradecendo, claro, ao João César, sempre muito brilhante, com questões importantes. E agradecer a Realizações pela oportunidade de nos ceder esse espaço virtual, né? E por ter lançado o seu livro extraordinário. Recomendo a leitura do seu livro a todas as pessoas, principalmente os interessados em ética, da, em ética e ciência, filosofia da ciência. Devem ler o seu livro, tem muitos insights poderosos ali. Muito obrigado, Jean-Pierre.
Muito obrigado, Maurício, e muito obrigado, Jean-César.
Muito obrigado.
Eu queria pedir a vocês de convencer o seu presidente que o vírus é uma coisa séria, senão não vou poder voltar no Brasil, né? E seria uma grande pena. Bom, ok? I count on you.
Isso eu vou deixar para o João César. O João César vai fazer essa, vai desempenhar essa tarefa de, na próxima viagem que fizer a Brasília.
Sim. Ok. Muito
bom. O argumento será absolutamente irrespondível. Ou o senhor leva o vírus a sério, ou Jean-Pierre Dupuy não poderá tomar café com Maurício Rigg na livraria. Pronto.
Ele vai.
Muito obrigado, Jean-Pierre. Parabéns.
Okay. Muito obrigado.
Um abraço, Maurício. Muito bom escutá-lo.
Um abraço. Muito obrigado. Okay.